On the banks of Loch Ness, in the Great Glen, one fine day 10 children, 5 lads and 5 lasses, were playing around by the water's edge, throwing stones from the banks and splashing at each other. In their excitement, they did not initially notice the murky waters beginning to ripple and foam until from the loch, a beautiful stallion, black as the night sky and with no blemishes on its smooth coat as the waters cascaded off of it. The children stopped their mucking about and stared at it in both shock and awe, for it was a very majestic and enthralling beast. Slowly, they approached the black stallion, and after stroking its nose and circling it with curiosity, the way children do, one by one they clambered on its back in an attempt to ride their new equine companion. The last, a boy, having helped his siblings and friends up onto the horse, reached for the horse's neck to stroke his mane. Suddenly, his hand became stuck as if the damp horse hair had become a rigid glue. He simply could not wrench the palm of his hand from its mane. The children soon discovered that they too, sat astride the beast, could not even attempt to dismount, and their thighs and calves were stuck to the horse. At this moment, the horse turned, dragging the boy with him towards the lake, going deeper and deeper. The boy, incidentally the eldest, realized he had no choice. He had to either cut off his hand or drown in the loch. He drew his antler-handled ski-in-do, a small knife often tucked into the stockings of lads, with immense pain, sawing his hand off as his chin went underwater, almost gargling the water he was bloodying with his self-amputation. He eventually hacked his hand off and scrambled ashore. He ran some distance before encountering a fisherman on the riverbank, who ran back with the boy, now pale and weak from blood loss, to the spot of the abduction. They ran back just in time to see a terrifying display of splashing and thrashing as the water horse drowned and devoured the 9 wee children. The fisherman and the boy could only look on in despair as the waters in front of them reddened with thick blood before the kelpie rose its gore-stained head from the loch and with a whinny that echoed across the glen, discarded the tangled heap of entrails from the children back to the shore. Before we begin to discuss what the kelpie is in depth, we'd like to thank the lovely Albion Doe, who we will link in the description for her beautiful illustration of the kelpie, which we had commissioned for the video, which you can see in the thumbnail. Albion Doe is, as you can see, a first-rate artist, a good patriotic lass, and should definitely go and check out her work for some wholesome, comfy and nostalgic drawings of British wildlife, big Beatrix Potter and Wind of the Willows vibes. Please go and support her work by buying prints and you can hope to see a fair bit more of her work in our videos to come. Nearly every major and minor body of water throughout Scotland will have a kelpie story associated with it, taken from the Gaelic kelpiach, meaning colt or heifer. The kelpie is a water-dwelling horse with appearances differing depending on the region. Aberdeenshire kelpies had the unique feature of having serpents for their manes, whilst the kelpie of the River Spey in the Highlands was in fact white. Some kelpies had manes of seaweed, some had hind parts of a dolphin or sea serpent, but on the whole they are almost exclusively dark and have backwards hooves, sometimes in common with their Icelandic equivalent, the nykur. Kelpies are known to shapeshift, sometimes as pretty young ladies such as in Ross and Cromarty, to lure men to a watery grave, sometimes as shaggy old men waiting under bridges to leap at a passing traveller and rip them limb from limb to gorge on. A tale from Barra in the Outer Hebrides, however, has the kelpie transform into a young man, handsome and strong to charm a local pretty girl that he wished to have as his wife. However, Kelpies in their human form are often identifiable to the observant eye, as they will have strands of aquatic vegetation in their hair. Whilst he sleeps, the fair maiden removed his silver necklace, which serves as his bridle, causing it to revert there and then to its horse form. She leads it back to the farm of her father, where the Kelpies put to good use for a year. Kelpies are immensely strong creatures, with the strength of 10 horses. After a year of solid toil, the girl rode her domesticated Kelpie to a local elder, a wise man of the island. The wise man tells the girl to return the necklace to the Kelpie, after which, having turned back into a handsome young lad, was asked by the wise man if he wished to be a Kelpie or a mortal, and before he answered, turned to the farmer's daughter and asked, if the lad was mortal, would she marry him? She answers that she would, and the Kelpie chooses mortality, and they get married. Due to their aforementioned horsepower, Kelpies were considered desirous to catch if possible, and is rumoured that the MacGregor clan has, as one of its heirlooms, a Kelpie bridle, acquired from a beast of the Loch Schlocht in Ross and Cromarty. The howling or wailing of a Kelpie signals a coming storm, and the creature has long been given satanic connotations due to its dark appearance and savage conduct, particularly popularised by the Address to the Deil by Scots language poet and Ayrshireman Robert Burns. When thaws dissolve the snowy herd, and float the jungling icy bird, then water Kelpies haunt the field by your direction, and nicktith travellers are lured to their destruction. Even once domesticated, however, Kelpies were known to still be dangerous. After being captured and mistreated by the Laird of Morphy in Aberdeenshire, using it to lug stones up a steep hill to help build his castle, the disgruntled Kelpie cursed the Laird. Sir Back, Sir Baines, thriving the Laird of Morphine Stains. The Laird of Morphiel never thrive, as lang's the Kelpie is alive. The Laird's line is said to have gone extinct shortly afterwards. Should the hauntings of a Kelpie become too much to bear, and its dispatching is required, silver bullets or heated iron spears are supposed to kill it, reducing it to a lump of soft gloop. Similar to the Kelpie, and often falsely attributed to it, or vice versa, is the Ekushka, literally Gaelic for water horse. This creature is limited to the highlands and only dwells in lochs and by the sea, unlike the Kelpie, which is more often associated with rivers. Much like the Kelpie, the Ekushka has an adhesive skin to trap its victims on before tearing them apart into chunklets, sparing only their liver, which floats back to the surface. So vicious and terrifying was this creature that many Highlanders are wary to this day of lone strangers and horses by the banks of a loch or the sea. The Isle of Lewis in the Western Isles has a hillock named Canoch na Beisht, meaning Monster's Hillock, where Ekushka was slain by the brother of a woman it had tried to eat. It not just eat humans, however, and the smell of roasting beef or mutton could lure it from the water. This proved a useful tactic when a blacksmith from Rasay, just off the coast of the Isle of Skye, wanted revenge for his daughter, who had been eaten by the Ekushka. Him and his son forged several iron hooks and roasted a sheep, keeping the hooks red hot by the seaside forge. Lo and behold, the Ekushka emerged from the sea in a terrifying anthropomorphic form, but a horse's head, where it attempted to make off with a sheep carcass. But the blacksmith and his boy drove the searing hooks into the water's beast and ended it. The Kelpie is a deeply ancient creature within Scottish lore and legend. It is quite possibly the Loch Ness Monster, the very same St. Columba had to fight and defeat in the 6th century AD. And more ancient still, a possible Kelpie-like creature appears on many of the Pictish symbol stones which dot the northeast coast of Scotland. Multiple depictions of what is known as the Pictish Beast actually account for nearly 40% of all Pict animal depictions. This was a very eminent creature to them, it would seem. Among the best of these stones are the Maiden Stone, or the Drumdurno near Inverary, Aberdeenshire, the Strathmartin Castle Stone in Angus, and the Mortlach Stone in Moray. In 2014, Scottish Canals had two twin steel horse heads erected in Falkirk's Helix Park, each 30 metres tall, towering over the Forth and Clyde Canal, in honour of the contribution of the role of the horse in Scotland's industry, pulling wagons, ploughs, coal ships and barges. They are known as the Kelpies, reflecting the immense strength of the Kelpies. So should you see a lone horse by the river, loch or seaside, be extremely wary, for it will likely drag you to a very unpleasant end. We hope you enjoyed this video on one of Caledonia's most grim and sinister creatures, yet also one of the more iconic beasts of folklore. Please like and share and subscribe, and leave feedback in the comments below. Join us this time next week for our series on Scotland's regiments, featuring the Cameronians, the Scottish Rifles.